All right, so we're getting close to wrapping up the series on these churches. This is the sixth church being referenced in Revelation chapter 3 here. We're going to cover the church of Philadelphia. So keep your place in Acts 18 because we're going to be going back to Acts 18. If you want to flip over to Revelation chapter 3, we'll see the message that was given to the church at Philadelphia. And then next week we'll close this series with the church of Laodicea. In Revelation chapter 3, verse number 7, the Bible reads, "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches." So we have here this message to the church of Philadelphia. It's a little bit better than the last one that we saw this morning. And we're going to start again just kind of right there near the beginning. That verse 7, it's just identifying who's speaking. Of course, this is Jesus Christ. It says, "These things saith he that is holy, he that is true." We know that Jesus Christ is holy and true. "He that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth." Just, you know, basically we're talking about God. If God's going to open up a door, it doesn't matter who's trying to fight against it, trying to close that door. Look, if God wants it open, it's going to be open.
That's right.
This is what he's saying. And if God's shutting it and it's closed, guess what? It's closed. It's done. No, you could try all day long to try to open that door. It's not going to happen. And there's a reason why this is being emphasized here. We see in multiple places this concept of doors being opened and closed, and we're going to actually look at multiple examples of this in Scripture. There's a couple that come to mind that I don't have in my notes of just when it comes to salvation, right? When the door is closed, the door is closed. When the door was closed on those virgins, we read that parable this morning. Remember the 10 virgins? There's the foolish virgins and the wise virgins. And, you know, the foolish ones didn't have oil in their lamps and they weren't ready. But the wise ones, they had the oil. So when the bridegroom came, he opened up the door. They're right there. Here we go. You're come in. You know, he opened up the door and it was open for them. And no one could shut the door on those wise virgins. But as soon as he shut the door, there was no getting in for the foolish ones. It was done. And it's the same thing with like in Matthew chapter 7, where, Lord, Lord, they're crying out to God. You know, have not we, you know, prophesied in thy name and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then shall he say, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, I never knew you. And when God shuts the door, when it comes to salvation, you know, when the door's shut, the door's shut. There comes a point, we were talking about this before service, I'm not going to get too far into this concept, but there comes a point with people where it's too late to get saved. You know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God wants everyone in the world to be saved. He wanted everyone in the world to be saved when they were created, when people were new beings. You know, God loved them and wanted them to be saved. But for everybody, there's a point at which that door of opportunity to be saved is shut. It closes. Now, for everybody, there's no getting around the door closing at death. mean, once you die physically on this earth, you have no more opportunities to get saved. It's not like, you know, there's an idea that kind of floats around. People go, what about people who didn't really have a good chance or didn't really hear a clear presentation of the gospel? They die, you know, is Jesus going to appear to those people after they die and they're going to get one more final chance? What about that tribe over in Africa that no one's been to? And, you know, all these different what ifs, what ifs, what ifs. Look, the scripture never says anywhere that Jesus will appear to people after they die in order to give them the gospel, to give them a chance to get saved. The Bible says that God has committed unto us the ministry of reconciliation, that we need to reconcile people to God in Christ's stead. So instead of Christ doing it, because he's no longer on this earth walking around physically and preaching the gospel to people as he was 2,000 years ago, ever since that time, he's committed unto us the ministry of reconciliation, which is every believer. It's your job to go out and preach the gospel to that tribe over in Africa that if they don't hear the gospel and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ are going to die and go to hell. It's your job to do that. Right. It's not his fault. It's not his problem. He's already done everything he needs to do for everybody to be saved. He loves those people. He wants them to be saved. But you know what? The job is on you. And you can't sit back and get lazy and go, oh, well, if we just don't preach the gospel to them, they'll still have a chance. I mean, think about how stupid is that? Who in the world, after you've lived and died, is going to go, nope, I don't want Jesus. I'll just go to hell. You're already dead. And then you're going to know, where's going to be the faith? You're going to know that these things are real. I mean, you've already died. The whole point of faith is that it's unseen. Right. So where's the hope? Where's the faith? Where is that of giving, you know, someone somehow receiving the gospel after they've died? I mean, if that was truly the case, the best thing to do would be nobody ever preach the gospel, and we could maximize the number of people that get saved, because then I'd be like I said, who's going to reject it? Who's going to reject it? Who's going to say, oh, okay, there's hell over there or heaven. Yeah, just send me into that fiery burning. You know, the only people that say, oh, I'm going to hell, they're proud of it, are the people who don't really believe in it. Right. They don't really believe it. They might want to act tough and sound tough. If they truly, honestly believed that they were going to be experiencing torture and torment in darkness and in fire, in being burned forever and ever and ever, they would not say they want to go to that place. They would not. Nobody wants to go to a place like that. You could sound tough all you want, nobody wants that. And once you're already dead, the choice would be a no-brainer and everybody would choose, oh, I'll just do that. But see, that's not the way God made it. That door shuts. You breathe your last breath, done. You've already made your choice. You don't have time anymore. Done. Now, for some people, that door closes even prior to breathing your last breath. And this goes into the reprobate doctrine, and I'm not going to go into all of that. But I'll give you a couple examples that are very, very clear, that are irrefutable from Scripture. One being, if you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, guess what? God shuts the door to your salvation. Yep. You could blaspheme the Father. You could blaspheme the Son. The Bible says that. But if you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, you never have forgiveness. Neither in this world, neither in the world to come. There is no forgiveness for that. You've just shut that door. That door's been shut. And you know what? You can't open that. And no one can open that door for you. That's been done. Anyone who ends up taking the mark of the beast, everyone who ends up taking the mark of the beast, door's closed.
Right. Yeah.
Door's closed. The Bible says that everybody that takes the mark of the beast is going to burn in hell. Door's closed. Simple as that. Anyone who tampers with the word of God, anyone who adds to or removes from God's word, door's closed. Three examples, right? I'm not even going to get into all the other applications and stuff. Very simple. Door can be closed. And here's the thing, that once that door is closed, it's closed forever. It's closed. There's nothing you can do about it. So what we need to do is use God's timing and say, hey, the door is open. As long as the door is open, let's utilize that and take advantage of the door being open. Because if God's opening up a door for you, he's opening up that door for you to walk through. Let's not be neglect that great opportunity that this door symbolizes. The door is a symbolism of opportunity. Opportunity for good things, opportunity for what God wants you to do. But he leaves a choice up to you, just like salvation. Hey, the choice is yours. I'm going to open up this door for you. This door that leads to eternal life. Everything's done. You just got to walk through that door. Good to go. In what we're going to see here, and with Moses' reference, these doors being opened, and especially what's being written here, told to this church of Philadelphia. In verse number 8, he says, I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. See, I brought up more references about doors being closed, right? It's kind of the focal point is, hey, when, you know, there comes a point where it's too late, the door is closed. But actually, most of the references to a door, it's an opening of a door. It's an opportunity. It's, hey, I've opened up this door. And the reason why it's so important to remember that no man can shut it, he that openeth, no man can shut it, is that when there's a door of opportunity that God is opening for you, you may have doubts about that door, about that possibility, about doing whatever work it is that God wants you to do. But you have to remember that if God is opening that door for you, no one can shut it. If God wants you doing that work, you don't have to worry about anything because that door will remain open as long as he wants you to do that job, and nobody can shut it. No matter how scary the devil may get, or the people who hate God try to intimidate you and cause you to fear and not do the work of the Lord, nobody can shut that door when God opens it for you. And what we're going to see, and you'll see from these examples that I have, is that these doors that are being opened are always evangelical in nature. When God opens up doors for people, it's all about preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is. Every time it's mentioned, I've got a bunch of examples. But let's finish verse number 8 in Revelation 3. He says, I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Saying, you know what? You still got some strength left in you, so I'm going to open up a door for you to do some more work. You've kept my word. That's good, right? These are positive things. Philadelphia, this church of Philadelphia, you've kept my word. You haven't denied my name. You've been good about sticking with me and sticking with the truth and sticking with the word of God. And you still have some strength, so I'm going to send you through this open door. And don't you worry, because nobody can shut it. Now, it's not specifically saying you're going to go out and preach the gospel in this verse right here. That's why I've got these other examples showing you about these doors that God opens are evangelical in nature. You can follow along with these if you want to write them down. I don't want to have you turn to all these references. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, I'll read all these for you. You can make note of them. 1 Corinthians 16 verse 8, the Bible reads, but I will tarry at Ephesus until Pentecost. This is Apostle Paul speaking. He says, I'm going to stay at Ephesus until Pentecost, for a great door and effectual is opened unto me, and there are many adversaries. So God has opened up this door in Ephesus for Paul to preach the gospel. And we know that's what he's doing. You can read the book of Acts and you can see his work and his ministry in Ephesus. And yeah, there were a lot of adversaries, right? And that's why it's important that, you know what though, when God opens up this door, it was a great door, he says, and effectual. He had a lot of effect. He had a lot of impact on a lot of people in Ephesus. Lots of people got saved. The church in, you read the letter to the Ephesians, the church in Ephesus that was started as a result of Paul and the other disciples' ministry to Ephesus, they did a great work. They got a lot of people saved, but there were a lot of adversaries as well. But when God opens up that door, no man can shut it. And he was able to get that work done. Acts 14 verse 27 says, and when they were come and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. So there's another door we see being opened up, and they're talking about, this is talking about Peter, and he was going to the household of Cornelius, and he had opened up the door basically for them to go and preach the gospel to these people who were Gentiles. And they're just basically saying, well, you know what? God opened up the door into them. Great. But as you see another example of this door being open, and what's the door? Salvation, the gospel being preached. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 12, the Bible reads, furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, and a door was opened unto me of the Lord. Again, God's opening up a door. What is he doing? He's preaching the gospel. I had no rest in my spirit because I found not Titus my brother, but taking my leave of them, I went from thence into Macedonia. So God opens up this door to preach the gospel. Just one more example. Colossians chapter 4, verse number 3, the Bible reads, with all praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. All these doors being opened by God all have to do with preaching Jesus Christ, preaching Christ's gospel, going into the world and preaching the gospel through adversaries. We saw in 1 Corinthians 16, he says, hey, there's many adversaries. In Colossians chapter 4, he says, I'm already in bonds because of this. He's in prison talking about, hey, pray for me to have more utterance because God's opened up this door and I want to keep preaching even though I'm in bonds. Obviously, there's people against him and there's adversaries and they're formidable, but God has opened up the door for the work to be done. And when God's opened it up, nobody can close it. God has done the same thing for this church in Philadelphia. We started off in Acts 18. If you have your marker there, go back to Acts chapter 18. Because we see this an example of an open door that God had opened for the Apostle Paul in Acts 18. Acts 18, verse number 8. The Bible reads, and Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all his house. And many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed and were baptized. Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision, be not afraid, but speak and hold not thy peace. Now, the context in the book of Acts, and you can read through, obviously, the book of Acts, you know, hopefully know it pretty well. There's lots of persecution going on. There's lots of great work, and there's lots of persecution. And in Acts 18, you read chapter 17, you know, there's the Apostle Paul is kind of going places and just really getting hammered and facing a lot of adversaries. But God is comforting him here and saying, don't be afraid to speak. Preach. Don't hold your peace. He says in verse 10, for I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in the city. So basically he's saying, go ahead and preach because I've opened up the door to Corinth and no man can shut that door. You'll be protected. You'll be safe. Do the work that I have for you. Don't be afraid. Do you think there was reasons for Paul to be afraid? Of course there were. Otherwise, why would God be saying, don't be afraid to speak, right? He knows that there's reasons for him to be afraid. He knows that there's adversaries. He knows there's going to be people coming at him and trying to get him to stop and trying to threaten him. But God's saying, you know what, Paul, I have your back. I have people here. You'll be fine. Just preach. I've opened up this door. And thank God he did. I mean, we've got letters to the Corinthians. We got two letters that are the word of God because of the church that was started there, because of this door that was open and the people that were able to get saved. Verse 11 says, and he continued there a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. So he was able to have a ministry that lasted a year and a half to the church at Corinth, or to the Corinthians, because God opened up that door. And you know, this isn't my notes, but we've got a door that's opened up for us. We've got a door, first of all, in Georgia that's wide open. Wide open. There are people getting saved every week. There are people who are very receptive here. There are people who are open to hearing the gospel. And the adversaries are few. They're out there, but you know what? We're able to get a lot of work done without fear of adversaries. We also have a great door, now a new door that's opened up, that's very effectual to help teach and train other people to preach the gospel. And this is exactly what we need and what I've been looking for. I'm super excited about this. I hope that you guys are too. I mean, just the thought of having a whole bunch of more people, people that could probably double the size of our, you know, over, total, double the size, the amount of soul winners going out. I don't care if they're affiliated with our church or not. It doesn't matter. If we could, if they could be taught and trained really well to go out and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, amen. Because you know what? We're all on the same team.
That's right.
We all want to see more people get saved. And this is a great opportunity. And I'm going to ask of all of you, you know, this door has been opened up to give and sacrifice of your time. And don't let this door close without getting involved and helping other people be discipled and taught and trained to preach the gospel, because we need more of that. That's why we do what we do. We're trying our hardest to go out and reach people and try to disciple them and get more people out to preach the good word, because there's so many people in this area. There's millions of people here that need to hear the gospel, and we are very few in number. So when we can double our, just our, as a team, efforts overnight, and you've got a whole bunch of people now are willing to get sacrifice their time and to learn, let's seize that opportunity. And this is an opportunity that I can't do myself. It's too much for one person. We all need to band together, and you know what? It's going to take sacrifice. You're going to have to give up some time to do this if you want this to work and be effectual. But you know what? God's opened up this door. Let's walk through it. For as long as this door is open, let's utilize it. Let's make the best of it. And let's give of ourselves for the greater cause. And be spiritually minded. It's exciting. Man, I, you know, the prayer has just been for so long. You know, I want God to build our church. I want God. We need to reach more people. I want to reach more people. We're doing a great work, but you know what? I want to see this thing grow and grow and grow. And you know what? I don't care if it doesn't come the way that I envision it. But right now is a great opportunity. I've been praying and hoping that there's also other churches, because I don't know. I'm new to the area. I'm new to the state. There's got to be other, you know, soul-winning churches just in general. They've got to be out there. I haven't heard the best report from people who've lived here locally and have tried different churches and stuff, but they've got to be out there. And the ones maybe that had a name where they lived but are now dead, I'm hoping that we could breathe some life. And I don't want to think too highly of myself or whatever, but look, it doesn't take much. Sometimes it won't take that much. We just need to get people motivated. We need to run into them. We've got someone from another church, right, Brother Mark, that goes out soul winning with you on Saturdays?
Every Saturday.
Every Saturdays. Praise the Lord for that. This is the type of impact. We may not see all of the results literally, physically, right here at this spot. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. We need to be focused on seizing these opportunities. You know what? God can decide where our opportunity is going to come from. Yeah. Let's let him do that. And let's be aware and awake to these opportunities so we could jump on them. You know, with this coronavirus, some opportunities, doors have been closed. You know, other ministry that we have with the now it's not completely closed, thank God. We've got an insider who's allowed inside to be able to still preach and reach the people there in that home. But you know what? We had people from our church going there regularly that are not allowed to do that anymore. So as one door closes, you know, hopefully it opens up again later, but as one door closes, we need to start, you know, keep our eyes open for these other doors. And we need to have the mind that doesn't get so used to one door that we miss open doors around us. I've been thinking about this a little bit more, and I'll probably end up preaching a little bit more about it another time, but there's so many things that you can do to preach the gospel. There are so many things. It takes work. It's going to take some planning and preparation and time. But individually, you can do. And I'll go into that a little bit more later, I guess, giving you a little bit better idea of the planning and all the specifics, at least to some degree. But we all have opportunities. You know, I brought up prison ministry before. You don't need me to tell you to do these things. Think about how you can reach people. Talk to me about them. I'd love to help you plan it out. It's exciting. You know, I'll help lead and guide the best I can. But we all face unique opportunities. And there may be opportunities I have no idea about, but you do. You need to be thinking about those things of how can, what else can we do? I mean, there's so many opportunities. You know, I'd like to be setting up booths at fairs and at parades and what, like just public events that are going on. All these opportunities where we could reach people. And this is where our mind needs to be, is thinking how many open doors are there around us that we're just walking past regularly because we've got blinders on, of we're only looking at this one door that we have of regular soul winning times going out door to door. And look, I'm not saying that we want to close that door. We're going to go door to door. I don't think that door is, you know, it's ever going to be closed for us, but that's what we're going to keep doing. But these other doors, we need to be looking for them. Let's go back to Revelation chapter 3. Man, that point ended up taking a lot more than I planned for the rest of the sermon here. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 9. The Bible reads, "Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee." Now, I went over this a little bit. I think it was the church of Smyrna. I'm not 100% on that. I think it was the church of Smyrna that also brought up this synagogue of Satan and the concept that they say that they're Jews and they're not. And I taught a lot about that, you know, from the book of John and from a few other places that said, you know, that basically who God views as being a Jew is one who is spiritually a Jew. They're the child of promise. He doesn't care about physically where you were born. Physically, are you the seed of Abraham? God doesn't care about that. He doesn't care about your lineage and your heritage and what color your skin is and where you grew. He doesn't care about that at all. Not even a little. He cares about whether or not you're a child of promise through faith. Just as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness. And we went over all those verses last time. I don't want to cover and re-preach all that. You can listen to that sermon again, because that's the groundwork that's really important for what I'm going to be covering as well again tonight. But when he talks about the same group of people, which are the people that religiously that we know as the Jews, right? The people who are of Judaism that are antichrist because they don't believe that Jesus Christ is the Christ. They deny the Lord Jesus Christ. These are the people that were around back then, that are still around today, that say they're Jews. They claim to be Jews, but they're not. Because God doesn't view them that way. Just like there's churches out there that claim to be churches, but you know what? They don't got a candlestick before God. These people are saying, hey, we're Jews, and they're not. And it has nothing to do with their lineage. It has to do with their spirit. But here's what he says about that group of people. He says, "Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee." Now, this church in Philadelphia, it's not talking about Pennsylvania, right? I think we all know that. This was a church in what's known in the Bible as Asia, but it would be like modern-day Turkey, okay? And these are Gentile people. This letter is not going out to a bunch of Jews, physically speaking, right? The physical nation of Israel up in Turkey. These are people who are despised in the eyes of the physical Jews. And the statement saying, I'm going to make them come and worship before thy feet, would be infuriating for the physical Jews then and the physical Jews now. Because these people who hold to this Judaism religion, who care about their lineage being physical Jews, being of the seed of Abraham, are racist. They're racist. Now, what's funny is that I'll be the one labeled a racist for preaching this sermon, for calling out racism for what it really is. I mean, literally putting more stock in yourself or in any group of people because of where you were born or what color your skin is or whatever. That is racist. That is saying that your race is superior. And these the Jews that are of, you know, the Judaism Jews, I'm not talking about just people who happen to be physically descended from Abraham, because it doesn't matter. It depends on what they believe. That religion teaches racism. And it permeates, and it's, look, I'm going to prove this from Scripture, because the Scripture shows us this, that this was part of their culture, that they believed they were better than other people. This concept of being the elect and God's chosen people went to their heads to the point of thinking that they were just superior to everyone around them. Because they didn't understand, yeah, you were chosen to be God's servants. You weren't chosen to be a master race of people. But even when, I mean, you can go ahead and look it up. These Orthodox Jews, even of today, they view the Goyim, the Gentiles, as subhuman, that you can do whatever you want to these people. It's written in the Talmud. It's written in their tradition of man, not in God's word. Their rabbinical teachings, where it's okay to lie and cheat and steal against the Goyim because they're subhuman. They're not that important. You're God's chosen person. That's not what the Bible teaches at all about even the physical seed of Israel, even in the Old Testament. It wasn't because they're some great super class of people. They have just been the ones that God chose because of Abraham, because Abraham was faithful in all his house, and Abraham believed, and Abraham had great faith. God blessed Abraham and said, you know what? And the Bible says, I've taught this on Father's Day, because Abraham was a great example of a good father. God said, I know him. He's going to teach his house and train his house to follow the Lord. And that's what he did. And that's why God chose Abraham and his seed to be blessed. Because Abraham was going to teach and train his household right. Which means they're going to multiply and reproduce, and they end up becoming a people. But with the foundation of faith in the Lord, that's why he said, hey, here's a man who's willing to give up everything and move where I tell him to move and do what I tell him to do. And he's got the faith, perfect person to start giving these blessings to and using to be a light in a dark world. That's it. And he did. And he used them and decided to use those people and then made promises, which is why he continued to use that people. Until it came to the point where Jesus Christ came and he came unto his own received him not. Right? But that because of all of that history, their understanding of who they were as a people turned into something that it wasn't, that God never intended it to be, and became part of the culture, which is evident in the book of Acts. Turn, if you would, to Acts chapter 22. And you're gonna witness here. And again, this doesn't mean that I'm not saying every single person who physically descended from Abraham was a racist. It's not what I'm saying. I'm saying these religious Jews that put stock in the fact that they're children of Abraham, the same people that Jesus was talking to, said, you know, that John the Baptist was talking to, you know, hey, God is able these stones to raise up seed unto Abraham, right? He says, think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For God's able to raise seed unto Abraham of these stones. That's what John the Baptist said. Don't, you know, because that's what they're trusting in. They're trusting in that. These are the people who are racist because they think that just because they were descended that they're a special class of people. And they look down upon others. In Acts 22, look at verse number 20. This is the Apostle Paul speaking to this group. You know, he gets arrested because there's, you know, there's a great tumult and he's preaching the gospel and you know, these Jews come and they have him arrested. You know, there's all kinds of chaos going on. And he asks to speak to the crowd for a minute, right? And he goes through this whole story and he talks about what happened to him on the road to Damascus. And he's going through everything until he gets to this one point, verse number 20. He says, he's recounting the story of Stephen being martyred, right, before his conversion. He says, "And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by and consenting unto his death and kept the raiment of them that slew him. And he said unto me," and he's recounting the story. This is Jesus speaking to Paul. "And he said unto me, Depart, for I will send thee far hence unto the Gentiles." Now, up to this point, he had told them, you know, his history and how he was persecuting, you know, all this stuff. And everyone was listening up. Everyone was quiet. Everyone was listening to him. Everyone was hearing what he had to say. And as soon as he gets to this point, depart, where Jesus tells him, "Depart, for I will send thee far hence unto the Gentiles." Look at verse 22. "And they gave him audience unto this word." So basically, they listened silently up until this one point and then lifted up their voice and said, "Away with such a fellow from the earth, for it is not fit that he should live." They became enraged at what he said when he said that the Lord was sending him to the Gentiles. That was enough to send them into a rage and said, "This guy just needs to be put to death." Why? Because they hated the Gentiles. Because they were racist. Because they thought that they can't, you know, "You think that God's going to send you on the, you know, this guy needs to be put to death." That's why they stopped at that point. They could listen to all this other stuff, but when it came to that, they're like, "No way." Couldn't stomach that. Even the disciples had a warped view because that was part of their culture and what they'd grown up with and were taught and learned. But see, God had to set them straight on that. It was never designed the way that they thought it was, that they're a special group of people, that in one sense, right, in the sense that they're superior, right? Acts 10:28, this was Peter speaking, he said, "And he said unto them, Ye know how that it is an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation. But God hath showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean." Now, when he said it was unlawful for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation, that is not in the law of Moses or the law of God. To come unto one of another nation? Sorry, you can't find that anywhere in the Mosaic law. It's not there. So obviously he's referring to another law. And this would have been a law that would have been set up by man's tradition and not by the word of God. Because that's why God had to correct him. He says, you know that it's unlawful for a Jew to go and talk to someone from another country, is what he's saying, another nation. That's not found in Scripture. Sorry. Now, were they allowed to marry heathen women that didn't worship the Lord? No. Of course, that was forbidden, right? There is definitely some things forbidden, but were they just not allowed to speak to someone from another nation? Of course not. How then can they even evangelize and proselytize people? And don't tell me that wasn't going on, because there's all kinds of parts of the law where people are allowed to join themselves unto Israel from other nations. How are you going to do that if you can't talk to someone from another nation? You can't. It would be contradictory in the law. It's not in the law of Moses, not in the law of God. Is a man-made law that became part of their culture because they hated these other nations and thought they were better than them. But see, God showed him that I should not call any man common or unclean. He said, no, for God so loved the world. And he even had to remind him, look at Deuteronomy chapter 32, because this is prophesied in the law of Moses, the law that these Jews wanted to hold and cling so tightly to that they didn't really believe, because if they would have believed Moses, they would have believed Jesus. But even in the law of Moses, it prophesies of events like the one in Revelation 3:9, which says that where God was saying, Jesus is saying, I'm going to make them come and worship before your feet. That the synagogue of Satan is going to come and worship before your feet, Gentiles. Deuteronomy 32, verse 15. The Bible reads, but Jeshurun waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxing fat. Thou art grown thick. Thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful, and hast forgotten God that formed thee. And when the Lord saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very froward generation, children in whom is no faith. Sounds like it describes the Pharisees to me. Verse 21, they have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities, and I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. Now, you say, Pastor Berzins, I'm still not seeing the connection. Turn, if you would, to Romans chapter 10, because this is quoted in Romans chapter 10. But I wanted to show you Deuteronomy 32, because this is prophesied way back in the Old Testament. I mean, in the law of Moses, talking about these so-called Jews being provoked to jealousy. Because what God's saying is, hey, you're going to try to make me jealous by going after gods that are not gods, going after these false gods and just ignoring me. Well, guess what? I'm going to provoke you to jealousy when I replace you, children of Israel, with a nation who's going to bring forth the fruits of the work that I have for them to do, and you're going to be cast out with the son of the bondmaid. Because you're children of the flesh and not children of the promise. You're going to cast out the bondwoman and her son. And I went over that last week. Romans 10, look at verse number 17. The Bible reads, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. But I say, did not Israel know? And now this is where he quotes it, verse 19. First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. But Isaiah is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. But to Israel he saith, all day long I have stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. And when you get Romans, even in context here, we're going to go flip over to chapter 11. Because it continues on in this same vein of thought. This is talking about Israel. I mean, Romans 10:1 starts off, I believe, that the Apostle Paul, let me just turn there, has, my desire for Israel is that they might be saved. That's how Romans 10:1 starts, right? Brother, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. So the context here, it's been a while since I've quoted that back, is talking about Israel. And then, of course, it goes through the famous passages, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved, and faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God, which we're here. But then he brings up this quote about Israel, that Moses said, hey, I'm going to provoke them to jealousy by them that are no people. And they were provoked. When the disciples started going and preaching the word of God unto the Gentiles, that provoked them to jealousy. They didn't want the Gentiles to hear the word of God. They followed them into these Gentile lands just to cause problems and to get them to stop preaching the word of God. When the Apostle Paul was trying to tell them about all this stuff that happened to him and give them his testimony and explain that Jesus Christ appeared to him in the way and then told him, hey, go to the Gentiles, they wanted to put him to death because he was being sent to the Gentiles. This was the culture. This is what they believed. They were racist. And it even permeated through to the disciples until God corrected them and got them straight on it. So then when you read all of Romans, you're seeing, hey, there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. Look at Romans 11, verse number 1. The Bible says, I say then, hath God cast away his people? God forbid, for I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. You know what? I'm saying the same exact thing. God didn't cast off just every single physical Jew of all the tribes or just all just cast off forever. No, because it's not about that. It's not about the physical. Verse 2, God hath not cast away his people which he foreknew. What ye not what the scripture saith of Elias, how he maketh intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they have killed thy prophets and digged down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. But what saith the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so then at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. The election of grace. The election of grace, not the election of being a seed of Abraham. Right. The election of grace. You say, you know what? Even today, at that time, there's still a remnant. There's still a small group of people that haven't just gone off the deep end and don't follow the Pharisees and their religion, but they're believers. They exist. They're not bowing down the knee to Baal and worshiping their false god, their idol that they set up, their Star of Remphan, like the Pharisees do. No, there's still some that are around. Verse 6, of course, and if by grace and it is no more of works, otherwise grace is no more grace, but if it be of works and it is no more grace, otherwise work is no more work. What then? Israel hath not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election hath obtained it, and the rest were blinded. Love that verse because it's saying unequivocally that physical Israel is not the election.
Right.
How can it be? Israel did not obtain, the election hath obtained. You've got one group of people that didn't obtain and one group of people that did obtain. One is Israel, the other is the election. The election are those that believe. Bottom line. And it's always been that way. Verse number 8, according as it is written, God hath given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see and ears that they should not hear unto this day. And that's a whole other sermon I could preach on that, about God literally hardening their hearts so that they can't believe and they can't see. And yes, God did that. God closed the door on many of these people to believing. And it, you know, and look, this only makes sense. I wasn't going to get into this, but just think about it for a minute. If you are putting yourself back into the days of Jesus and you're witnessing this man preaching the word of God, boldly going around, ministering to people, preaching God's word, and healing people, and just doing all of the miracles that Jesus Christ did, and you're there to witness this, you're seeing everything happening, you're hearing the words that he's saying, he's preaching like no man has ever preached before, he has his power and boldness, everything going along with it. If you've read your Bible and you're listening to this man, you're going, man, this is the power of God right here. How could you deny that? How? Unless God is, if God's blinded your eyes and hardened your heart and made it so you just can't hear. And just like Jesus said, you know what? I speak unto them in parables so that they won't understand. It's in the scripture. It may not line up with the way that you view Jesus or God or the Bible, but that's what it says. Anyhow, don't want to get off on that. Let's keep reading here, Romans 11, verse number 9. And David saith, let their table be made a snare and a trap and a stumbling block and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened that they may not see and bow down their back alway. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation is come unto the Gentiles for to provoke them to jealousy. Again, just further explaining what we saw in Romans 10 from Deuteronomy, that this opening up the door to Gentiles is provoking Israel to jealousy. Now, if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify mine office. Paul has no problem being an apostle of the Gentiles. That is great. I magnify my office. If by any means I may provoke to emulation them which are my flesh, and might save some of them. He still has a heart for Israel. Physical Israel. He's like, I want them to be provoked to jealousy. I want them to get upset. I want them to get angry and mad and just and think about it and say, you know, and see what's going on if I could provoke them to get saved. For if the casting away of them be the reconciling of the world, what shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead? And you know what? The more people I get saved, the better. Amen and amen. This isn't, if I were a racist, I wouldn't want them to get saved. Right? I wouldn't want the physical, I don't want these Jews to get saved because whatever, right? If I was racist, that would be the racist thing to say. Isn't that what they did with the Gentiles? Don't go preach to them. Don't go minister to them. Don't preach the word to God to them. They wanted to kill Paul because he was telling them that that's what he was going to do and that's what he was told to do by God. That's the racist thing. I'm not the racist. I'm a Bible-believing Christian. When you look around at our church, yeah, I'm a racist. Right? The reality is that God has never viewed the Israelites as better than any other person, and God has always looked at the heart. Uh-oh, you guys are in trouble. It's died. And I have no idea how long I've been preaching for now. If I had learned how to read a clock, then I might be able to figure it out, but I think I got some time. I know I got some notes left. Turn to turn to Romans chapter 3. Just stay in Romans. I'll read from Acts chapter 15. I had a lot of notes. And I kind of want to get through some of these a little bit quicker. Talk about God looking at the heart and not considering Israel to be better than, physically just better than anyone else. Acts 15 verse 7, the Bible reads, "And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us. And put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith." Peter's even saying, look, God put no difference between us and them. No difference. Their hearts are purified just like ours through faith. Not by keeping the law, not by being a better person, not by being more holy and righteous and spiritual, but because they believed on Jesus Christ too. Amen. Making no difference between the two. Verse 10, "Now therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear?" This is when they're talking about, well, what should we tell these Gentile believers to do? I mean, they got to follow the law. They got to be circumcised. And Peter's going, look, that didn't work for us. You think it's going to work for them? Then they're believers like us. We're saved the same way. There's no difference. So let's not make a difference. You know, which is also why I don't like that there's these messianic Jews. Yeah. Like, why don't you just call yourself a Christian? That's right. Why are you making a difference between you and any other believer? Who cares? There should be no difference. It doesn't matter at all. It shouldn't matter at all. Verse 11 says, "But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved, even as they." Then all the multitude kept silence and gave audience to Barnabas and Paul, declaring what miracles and wonders God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. And after they had held their peace, James answered, saying, "Men and brethren, hearken unto me. Simeon hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. And to this agree the words of the prophets, As it is written, after this I will return and will build again the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up, that the residue of men might seek after the Lord, and all the Gentiles upon whom my name is called, saith the Lord, who doeth all these things. Known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world. He's quoting the Old Testament, talking about the Gentiles seeking after the Lord and saying, look, God knew these works from the beginning of the world. So God was right, and that's what he taught from the Old Testament into the New Testament, that understanding had gotten lost along the way because of just sin and bad preachers and teachers and people teaching false doctrine on the importance of being a physical Jew. But God has been teaching consistently from the beginning, from the Old Testament. Romans 3, look at verse number 1. What advantage then hath the Jew, or what profit is there of circumcision? Look at verse 2. It says, much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. So when he's going through, and again, you can read through all of Romans, talking about a lot about the Jews and Gentiles. He's saying, well then what's their advantage is there to being a Jew? Is there even an advantage? And he says, you know what? There is an advantage to being a Jew. Being a Jew, physically born in Israel, what is the advantage? Well, the advantage is that you are born into a place where you have the oracles of God, where you've got prophets preaching the word of God. That is an advantage. Today would be the advantage of being born into a Christian home. Right. You've got parents that could teach you the Bible and you're hearing the word of God. There's an advantage to that. Of course there is. So there's an advantage, but it has nothing to do with the tone of your skin or the shape of your nose or your ears or your hair or whatever. Like, it doesn't matter at all. It would just be because you're hearing the word of God. Verse 3, for what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? God forbid. Yea, let God be true, but every man a liar, as is written, that thou mightest be justified in thy sayings and mightest overcome when thou art judged. But if our unrighteousness commend the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unrighteous who taketh vengeance? I speak as a man. God forbid, for then how shall God judge the world? For if the truth of God hath more abounded through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner, not rather as we be slanderously reported, and as some affirm that we say, let us do evil that good may come, whose damnation is just. Look at verse number 9, though. This is where I wanted to get to. What then? Are we better than they? That's the question. Now, why is he even bringing up this question? The question is because a lot of people thought, yes. You don't need the teaching. Everybody's in agreement. Of course we're not better than them. They did think that. Are we better than they? No. In no wise. For we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin.
Yep.
As it is written, there's none righteous, no, not one. There's none that understandeth. There's none that seeketh after God. They're all gone out of the way. They're together become unprofitable. There's none that doeth good, no, not one. Amen. See, we're all sinners. We're not better than them. Not better than any other sinner. You're a sinner too. Yep. Jews aren't better than anyone else. Jews need a savior. Right. Children of Abraham need a savior. The children of Isaac need a savior. The children of Jacob need a savior. Children of every human being need a savior. Because you're all sinners. You're not better than someone else. You're not better because of the way you look. You're not better because of where you're born. You have an advantage if you're born into a house that preaches the word of God. But that's it. That's the extent of your advantage. I mean, we read this thing in context. There was nothing else that he said. What profit is there of circumcision? But nothing. Later, you're going to see in Galatians, you know what? Circumcision profiteth nothing. Hey, if you can't keep the entire law, then don't even worry about the circumcision because you're gonna fail somewhere else. No, salvation has always been by grace through faith. God uses, and he used it with this people. One last thing that's kind of interesting with this message to the Church of Philadelphia is this one, there's a couple others where there's a few statements made that I feel they're kind of prophetic beyond the church. And the reason for that is because It's not that God's trying to make a prophecy out of these. It's just a truth that also applies to end times. So you say, what do you mean by that? Well, I don't know how this specifically played out for the synagogue of Satan worshiping at their feet in history. But I believe it happened with these people. Because these letters were written to these churches. I don't think it was just talking about the future, like way, 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 way down the line, like in the millennial reign of Christ or something. I don't think that. But I do know that that is going to be happening during the millennial reign of Christ. That the you know, when there's still unbelievers on this earth are going to be worshiping, and everyone's going to be worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ, believer, unbeliever. And we're going to see it. So I think there is a level of prophecy still to that. And then also here in verse number 10 of Revelation chapter 3, we're almost done. There's only two verses. Bible says, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. I believe for the faithful people, you know, we don't all know what God's plan is specifically for us. But when the Bible says, like in Matthew 24, you know, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. When it talks about people enduring, I think those are the people who are watching. Those are the people who are prepared. Those are the people that are going to experience a special gift of being able to make it through the trials and the tribulation, the great tribulation period, and be able to see the Lord Jesus Christ come in the air, come in the clouds, and be caught up together with him and see their salvation coming. I think that's a special blessing that you get for being faithful, being ready, watching and everything else, that the coming of the Son of Man is not coming on you as unawares. But you've been ready for it. You've been prepared to go through the hard times, and you haven't backed down. And because God is able to protect you in all situations, even with the Antichrist coming after you and any other child of the devil coming after you, God is able to protect you. So those who have been proving themselves to be faithful, to be good stewards, to be good ministers of the word, God is going to be able to keep you through. And I don't know how, and I don't know the specifics of it, but I trust and I know that God is able to do that. He's always been able to do that. He's been able to do that with his prophets that thought they were completely alone. He still kept them safe. He kept Elijah safe from Ahab and Jezebel. He kept all of his prophets safe, doing the work when they did the work faithfully. It doesn't matter how many people are against them. It doesn't matter if the Satan himself is against them. God is going to be able to keep you safe. And I believe that he will, even during the tribulation. Now, many people we know are going to be put to death and martyred. And there may be some people who are faithful and good that may, like Stephen, the martyr, right? I mean, he was faithful. He was doing everything right. But he ended up facing a martyr's death. And there's going to be some people like that. But I think there's also going to be this a group of people who, because they were faithful, will end up being able to make it through. And I think there's going to be a lot of people who, when the Son of Man comes, they're saved, but it's going to be unawares. And they're going to end up getting wiped out probably first and being put to death and killed and whatever because they weren't ready for it. But you can believe that or not. That's the way I see things going down. But like he says here in verse 10, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. It's the same concept, similar concept of keeping you to go through that and come out in the end. Verse number 11, behold, I come quickly, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Now, the last point, and I'm going to go through this kind of quickly. This can turn into an entire sermon in itself as well. And I've talked to people about this before, the concept of losing reward. So if you would to Luke 19, I'm going to just touch on it right now. Because what I believe is that there's some rewards that you can lose out on and some that you can't. And when the Bible says in Revelation 3:11, he says, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take that crown. You're saying, he's telling you to hold on because so that no one would take your crown. To me, that implies that it's possible for someone to take your crown. Now, what I believe, and we're going to read it in this parable in Luke 19. I think it sums it up pretty well. But one of the, you call it a crown. A crown symbolizes being in authority, right? You're a ruler. On this earth, you know, there's not an infinite number of ruling positions. It's not unlimited. So when Jesus sets up his kingdom on earth, there are going to be a limited number of nations, a limited number of seats of holding different various positions of power and ruling, right? So because of that, these opportunities to have a crown, to have the authority, are limited. So it's going to be given to those that are doing the most and working the most. They're going to get the most rewards and the most crowns, as it were, the best crowns, that no man can take that crown. So, I mean, think about it. If you did very little, but there's not very many people that are even capable of filling that position, well, by default, you'll just get it, right? Because you don't have very much competition. But we've got a lot of people who have lived, a lot of believers that are going to be there in the millennium to have potential positions to rule and reign in varying degrees, right? And of course, you know, you've got a lot of authority and just kind of going down to being able to have all kinds of, so I think that there's a lot of positions, but it's still limited. There's still a limited, I mean, there's a finite number of what that's going to be. And if we aren't working as hard, you're not going to get as much. Hopefully this make a little bit more sense when we read Luke 19. Look at verse number 12. The Bible says, he said, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy till I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a message after him, saying, we will not have this man to reign over us. And it came to pass that when he was returned, having received the kingdom, then he commanded these servants to be called unto him to whom he had given the money, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, Lord, thy pound hath gained 10 pounds. And he said unto him, well, thou good servant, because thou hast been faithful in a very little, have thou authority over 10 cities. And this is where I would make the distinction of, like, that authority can be considered a crown. Right? Okay, here's a crown for you to rule over these 10 cities. And the second came, saying, Lord, thy pound hath gained 5 pounds. And he said likewise to him, be thou also over 5 cities. And another came, saying, Lord, behold, here is thy pound, which I have kept laid up in a napkin. So this guy didn't do anything. God gave you talent. God gave you something, and you did nothing with it. You completely wasted it. You did nothing for him and just said, well, here you go. Take that. That's yours. Verse 21 says, for I feared thee, because thou art an austere man. Thou takest up that thou layest not down, and reapest that thou didst not sow. He saith unto him, out of thine own mouth will I judge thee, thou wicked servant. Thou knewest that I was an austere man, taking up that I laid not down, and reaping that I did not sow. Wherefore then gavest not thou my money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required mine own with usury? And he said unto them that stood by, take from him the pound, and give it to him that hath 10 pounds. They said unto him, Lord, he hath 10 pounds. They're like, okay, take that one, give it to this guy. Give it to the top producer. Like, man, you've already given him a lot, you know. Verse 26 says, for I say unto you that unto everyone which hath shall be given, and from him that hath not, even that which he hath shall be taken away from him. And then verse 27, he says, but those mine enemies which would not that I should reign over them, bring hither and slay them before me. So there's another parable that's similar to this, but not exactly the same, that I think teaches something slightly different. In this situation, these servants, the ones that got the 10 talents, the 5 talents, and the 1 talent, I believe they're all saved. And they're all, you know, Jesus is reckoning with them when he comes back at his return, saying, okay, well, what have you done? Right? Judgment seat of Christ. What have you done? This guy said, well, here's what I did. You know, I made another 10. Okay, great. You're getting rewarded. You're going to get these crowns. because you've done all of this. And then, you know, this other person, they're getting crowns. But this one, he's like, well, this is what I had. But he didn't really do anything. He didn't hold fast that which he had and did more like Revelation is teaching him to do. And holding fast that he has, he's not talking about the time, he's talking about the good things that they were doing. Right? Sorry, in Revelation 3, hold fast that which thou hast means the good things that you're doing, keep doing them. That no man take thy crown. This guy didn't do anything, and he says, you know what? You're losing that. I gave that to you originally, but you know what? This guy's going to get it because you weren't doing anything. And then he takes, you know, the enemies, they're getting cast into hell. They're being destroyed. But these people, it varies on what people are going to get. And I think that, you know, those crowns are up for grabs. And it's going to be based on your works. And that's clear, that the rewards you get are going to be based on how hard you're working. And the Church of Philadelphia is being warned here, like, hey, you know, hold fast that which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. You've earned, you know, you've done enough work to earn a crown, but, you know, keep going strong so that you don't just kind of give it up and squander it or lose it. Not losing salvation, just the potential to not have some rewards, and specifically a crown is a position of authority. And to me, it makes sense that if you're going to end up failing later, you can blow your opportunity to be an authority. Right? You can do a lot of good work. And to me, this just makes sense. It's kind of like, you know, the requirements to pastor a church, you know, you have to be a husband of one wife. Okay? If someone has failed in a marriage and gotten divorced and they're not the husband of one wife, they can't fulfill that office of a bishop anymore. It doesn't mean they can't serve God. It doesn't mean that there's not a lot of good things they can do, but they're not going to be entrusted with that position to be in that level of authority when they've already failed. And I believe that the crown specifically, because I don't know what all the rewards are going to be, but the crowns is definitely one of them. If you've blown it here, and you could have been working and doing all kinds of great things for the Lord, and then like Solomon just kind of blows it at the end of his life and just does some really bad things, you know, and just kind of peters out and fizzles out, and just, you know, he may have, like, he has already had experience, and if he would have just stayed strong, man, he could have been in authority over that. I think that he's not going to be in authority, or at least in a high level of authority, in the kingdom of God, because he blew it. I think that crown is going to go to someone else who didn't blow it, who didn't just, you know, stay strong and stay firm into the end. It doesn't mean that I think he's not going to get any rewards. I just don't think he's going to be put in that position of authority. I think he blew that opportunity. So that's my take on it. If you're interested, you know, this isn't some critical doctrine. It's a little bit more conjecture. It's the way that I see the Bible fitting together when you look at these different parables. So hopefully that's helpful for you. But let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for all that we can learn from these churches. I pray that you would please help our church to do the work that you've set before us. Lord, help us to be able to see the doors that you open for us, that we can take advantage of them to do more work for you, Lord. We want to do and reach the most amount of people we can, and we ask for your guidance and your help and your Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Ghost to come upon us and help us to do this great work, Lord. And I thank you for bringing this group of people together here. It's such a great church family that you've brought together here and built. Lord, continue to build this body and help us to do what you have planned for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.